our first session of Chai and Chat, which, as you know, is an informal forum for all the film lovers to meet the filmmakers, writers about cinema. So this session's on the 23rd, which is today. 25th, we have the Greek cinema, same time, same place. 27th is Meet the Jury. I feel like I'm talking to myself. Can we have your attention, please? If you're here, please be here for Chai and Chat, not just for chat and chat among yourselves, because you'll have the mic and, you know, you'll have an occasion to talk. So as I was saying, this is the first session of Chai and Chat, and you're all welcome. And the second session is on the 25th, which is you'll meet the Greek filmmakers. There are four Greek filmmakers and film writers. On the 27th, you'll meet the jury, the international jury. It'll be an informal interaction. By then, they'll have seen the films, so you could discuss with them the kind of films that were entered in the competition and any questions you have for them, other than, of course, what awards they've given. And on the 29th, we thought we'd have an interactive session with the film organizers, the film festival organizers, and film delegates like yourself. So the good and the bad and the ugly, everything can be discussed for the way forward to IFFI 2014. So today's session is specific. It's a piece to Soul of Asia. So we called it Soul Seekers Cinema. So I'm going to introduce the panel and then hand over to Harsh Mandar, who's moderating this session. So on my right is Vince Sandoval. He's from Philippines, and he just arrived yesterday. Vince has a wonderful film called Apparition, which is shot in the Philippines, of course, which is a story of nuns who are caught between a conflict where they have to leave the real world, both physically and mentally. And it's not easy, of course. You can talk more about it. To his right is Mr. Harsh Mandar, who I think most of you must have read. He's a national film critic and a journalist. More than that, he's an activist who left the government to work with street children and hunger issues. So I have a great regard for Harsh Mandar. On the right of Harsh is Pan Nalin, the well-known filmmaker who's now based in Paris. Like somebody else we know, he too was a tea boy before in Ahmedabad. And now, last year we opened Soul of Asia with his film Samsara, which, as you probably know, it's a pretty mind-blowing film. And his film, this year he's screening Faith Connections, which you'll discuss with them. Faith Connections is being screened tomorrow at Soul of Asia at 11:45 in the morning. And on his right, I'd like to introduce Narayani Ganesh, who's, I think probably you've all read her name. She's a senior journalist with the Times of India. And more important, she's here as the editor of The Speaking Tree, which is a spiritual section of the Times of India, which she started way back 18 years ago, and she still edits. So over to Harsh.
Thank you, Meera. When Meera invited me to coordinate this discussion, I thought I'd needed to do a full disclosure very quickly. I said I'm a practicing agnostic, and I'm not sure I'm the right person to moderate this panel. So she wanted to know what a practicing agnostic is. So I told her somebody who has respect for everyone's faith and the absence of faith, but believes that you should lead a good life for no reason except that it's a good life. So, but I was reassured. The films that I saw yesterday and most of what I saw today and hearing Pan and Vincent speak yesterday reassured me that this set of films is not so much about faith as about interrogating faith, and I felt more comfortable. You know, the film that I had to leave before the end, and I will catch up with it, The Gardener, the dialectic between the father and the son as filmmakers about religion were extremely valuable. I mean, I felt I was part of that discussion when his son says religion has always starts with justice and compassion and peace and ends with war and hatred, and his father replies, just because you burn with a fire doesn't mean you shut down all the oil wells. And I thought that was really profound. But I'd start with asking Vincent, because of all the films, I think his film Apparitions, which I haven't seen, which I really look forward to seeing, sounds one that most closely interrogates faith. And what would he like to say about it?
Certainly. When I made Apparition, even though it's set in the backdrop of a monastery, and it's actually set in 1971, which is a few months before the declaration of martial law by then late President Ferdinand Marcos, it's about a group of nuns in a monastery who think that they could isolate themselves from things that are going on around in society until one of them falls victim to it, and they have to really wrestle with, you know, their emotions and their role in society because of that. And it's more of a philosophical film in a way, because 15 years later in 1986, it was at the People Power Revolution in the Philippines that dethroned President Marcos, and it was actually the nuns that were marching in the streets, you know, offering flowers to the soldiers. And it was, you know, a nonviolent revolution, so to speak. So I wanted to explore how the nuns, who in 1971 can only have been very conservative and very typically Catholic in their mindset, go from a politically indifferent position to one that's a lot more involved and militant. So I was wondering what event could have helped provoke that transformation within themselves from, you know, from point A to point B. So,
carry on with the session.
Since Meera talked about child labor, one of the great debates in this country, not debated enough, people say that child labor is inevitable as long as there's poverty. But our point is that poverty is inevitable as long as there's child labor. And what you just said about the child not being able to escape his poverty because he was in labor and not in a school. Otherwise, maybe he would have built a different life. And I think we need to understand that. In another incarnation, I helped draft a new amendment to the child labor law, which says all child labor needs to be abolished and not only that in hazardous work. And I'm hoping it comes up in Parliament shortly so that these boys have a different future. But coming back to the central theme of our of this, in many ways, I think, as I said, the soul of Asia, and Meera had said yesterday in her presentation that it is transitioning from a more literal set of films about faith to those that interrogate faith in different ways. How do you see the speaking tree and your engagement with it in terms of understanding faith?
Well, faith itself has several dimensions, as we know, and every religion, every organized religion is also interpreted in different ways by those who read different meanings into the scriptures. So faith is something that is very personal, although you also belong to a community of the faithful. And I think, for instance, if you come to films where earlier it was a direct interpretation of faith, and you usually had biographies of saints, and you had movies which depicted the story of someone with who was devout. But now you have films like, for instance, Vincent's, which present ethical questions or even moral conundrums, which, of course, were what were being addressed by religions in a more organized manner. But the world has changed so much that there's no black and white anymore. There's more of twilight zones and gray zones, what we call. So there's no, nothing is right or wrong. There are a lot of things in between. So, and I think there, no single religion can really help out. And therefore, I think in a multi-ethnic, multicultural society, we need to borrow from each other. And I think that's what the Speaking Tree is trying to do in the Times of India by presenting perspectives from different faiths, and agnostics as well as atheists, because those are also loosely termed belief systems. So that's what we are trying to do at the Speaking Tree.
Great, in this discussion.
Yeah, I would, I mean, I personally, I believe in definitely more in spirituality and not really in the religion, even though I was brought up in Hindu way of life. And over the years, you know, whatever my understanding of religions have sort of pushed me away from all kind of religious belief because of the mess, you know, which exists regardless of which religion in the world. So I do believe that that there is definitely something there, an energy, a light source, a spirit. I would like to believe in that supreme force and have my own definition of what my faith should be. And also, I think that it's human need. As much as we need water and oxygen, we need to believe in something. So you might believe in Gandhi, Buddha, or Bob Marley, but that belief has to be there. And that's what makes it really powerful. And what is really surprising is that as the religions are sort of falling apart, there is such great movement towards religion. I mean, people are like flocking to religions and opening institutions. And today we have built more temples and mosques and churches and synagogues than ever in the history of humanity. And at the same time, people are desperately seeking spirituality world over. So I'm for spirituality.
You're part of that search, but people desperately need. But at some time, we found that people were following Baba Marx as well as one more religion. How would you locate yourself, Narayani?
I'll tell you a very small story. Once my editor, Jack Suraya, he was rushing off because he said that this Sai Baba, Puttaparthi Sai Baba, was going to give darshan in somebody's house in central Delhi. And he said, I'm rushing off. So I said, may I come with you? He said, well, okay. He said, I can squeeze you in. So while we were, you know, running under that subway to the car, he said, so you're a devotee of Sai Baba, I see. I said, oh, no, did I give you that impression? He says, no, you're so keen to meet him. I said, well, you are keen to meet him too, but you're not a devotee. So then he says, who do you believe in? Who's your guru? I said, I think I believe in me. And then we laughed. I mean, like, it was just a spontaneous reply. And not to belittle anyone who believes in a guru, but I think, as someone pointed out, that you need to have faith in something, and not everyone is strong enough or, you know, to just not believe in an external guru. And I think the gurus and the masters are doing a great service as long as they are not out to cheat people. If they are legitimate ones, and I think it's a lot of what do you call, when people are troubled and they go and listen to a guru or they unburden themselves, like that girl did in The Patient Stone. Her comatose husband, she could just speak out all her suppressed feelings. And well, in a very peculiar sense, he was playing the role of a guru, you might say. I mean, although of course he wasn't. But you need to unburden yourself, and I think if some people feel good unburdening themselves to a guru, why not? But as for speaking tree, I mean, doing editing all the various articles which come in from different faiths and non-faiths, I feel like a bee flitting from one flower to the other, drinking in the honey and enjoying myself. And I think it's a great experience, and it has indeed widened my perspective of the world, made me more understanding and less judgmental when I see people of faith.
Yeah. My best response was expected, I'm telling you. See, if you say religion is communalizing the society, I'm answering the question. Communalism, I'm telling. See, in democracy also communalism exists. Even there are all democratic parties. They are all communal in the sense there are different groups. Groups are communities, and all the democratic parties are also fighting with each other. So communalism exists in democracy also. Communalism exists in a secular India also, in a democratic format. In the democratic format, there are always political murders before every democratic elections.
Okay, son, can I think that, see, communalism is a term that that is very specifically South Asian. It doesn't mean the same thing elsewhere.
So, sir,
can we have one more question, I think, from one more person before we wind down?
Democracy could not unify the society.
Okay.
That is what my point is.
Okay.
No, you understand?
Well taken. Let's continue the discussion over tea. Is there any one more point because we need to wind down?
Yeah. I have a question for Harsh Mandar. I want to know what is being an agnostic. What does it mean? And because I see you in different places of faith, so how do you combine that?
I think that, you know, agnosticism is very different from atheism, because atheism is also a certainty. There is no God, is what atheism is. There is this God, and this is what he taught, is what religion says. I feel that the only scientific, rational and humane approach is to say, I don't know. And it is that I don't know. I have no way of knowing. But my agnosticism carries me one step further, that not only do I not know, it is not important for me to know when I decide about what kind of life I should lead. So I'm respectful of your faith if it helps you become a better human being. I'm not judgmental of your faith. But I believe that I should try to look for the reason to be to lead a good life, not in any sense of the afterworld, but in this world itself. So I think we'll wind up now. Yeah. I just wanted to thank. I thought we had a lovely discussion. I wish we could have gone on. And maybe we should meet after the films and have a further discussion. It's lovely to meet, and I look forward to seeing Vincent's film and Pan's film hugely, as I'm sure all of you are, and the rest of the Soul of Asia films. I'll give it over to Meera to thank and announce the next session.
I just wanted to let you know that Pan's film is on tomorrow at INOX 4 at 11:45. And Vince Film Apparitions is on the 27th. On the 27th at 11:45 at INOX 4. Faith Connections, of course, is the title of Pan's film, as everybody knows. And the next session of Chai and Chat will be on 25 November. And that will be on Greek cinema. And that will be... starting at 1:15 to 2:15. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.